We're talking to Barry Crimmins. How are you?
I'm great, David. It was great to hear you wanted to do your podcast with me today. I get some requests for podcasts. I got a message today from a guy who said, I'm a 25-year-old who has a podcast. And I'm thinking, how old do you have to be before you stop telling people? I mean, it's cute if a 9-year-old writes you, you know, but I was like, you're fucking 25. You know, I'm like, Jesus Christ, you know, what are we going to talk about? Pokemon? You know, like, what the fuck? You know, like, seriously? Honest to God. I'm a 25-year-old with a podcast. Really? You're still telling your age? Jesus Christ. I hope it's not somebody, you know, with some sort of challenge or something, and I feel guilty about that. But otherwise, it's like, I'm a 25-year-old. Really? You're a 25? Like, can you remember telling people you were 25 when you were? I was just acting like I was an adult at that point, trying to, not succeeding.
Yeah, I told people I was 25 when I was in my 40s. Hey, what were you doing when you were 25?
I was doing Under the Stone at Skin Atlas when Gold Plate and Kenny and Wendell Wild and all those guys showed up.
What was Under the Stone?
That was my weekly show in my hometown, Skin Atlas, New York. I was home for a while, and we did, you know, 7 or 8 months there, and then started doing some other stuff around the central New York area, and then I ended up in Boston right after that.
So you grew up in upstate New York, correct?
Yes, I can speak the native defeated tongue of upstate New York. 193 inches of snow last year just out of my house so I could open the door again and work on my alcoholism. You know, so. Yeah. Jesus Christ there, David. Canals is an Indian word that means beautiful lake surrounded by fascists. Yes, and I'm from there. And now it's all dressed up to look like itself. As my friend Huxford says, you can get anything your horse needs except food. And we have like 24-hour-a-day Christmas tree shops. It's just unbelievable how many places there are to get Christmas ornaments there.
When you were growing up, was there a manufacturing base?
No, I mean, it was a tourist town. It's a beautiful lake, and you know, but I mean, the downtown, there was everything. You could walk down the street and go to a grocery store, a hardware store, a pharmacist, or whatever, and now all those places are taken over by the wives of Big Brother on Prozac selling, you know, bric-a-brac. Mm-hmm. And it's just hopelessly precious. There's still a couple of stores left you can buy stuff at, but most of those have been moved over off the main street down to Fennel Street, where there's a, you know, a couple of plazas and they're chain things and whatever, you know, it's over.
Very quickly, before we get to the trivial stuff like Trump and whatever, Tom Kenny, Paul Kozlowski, where are they from?
Yeah. Tom Kenny's from East Syracuse, as is Gold Plate, and Paul Kozlowski is from down to Cortland.
How far is Syracuse from where you grew up? I can't pronounce your town.
It's about 20 miles, 17 miles, something.
17 miles.
And
so
that was, yeah, that was a big deal to go to Syracuse.
So you're all from that same area. You all drank the same water. Did you all move to Boston at the same time? Did you know Goldthwait before he moved to Boston?
Oh, yeah. No, he and Tommy started at my show. I discovered Gold Plate and Kenny. That's my claim to fame.
And then who moved to Boston first?
Me.
And then when did they come?
Yeah, within a year.
When did you move into the barracks?
Well, you know, I moved in, but I almost never stayed there. Thanks to the good graces of the young women of the Boston area. I moved in there probably after about 6 months. I would say sometime in the middle of 1980.
Did Mr. Meany live in the barracks?
Yes, he did.
And when did he move into the barracks?
I would say probably 81 at some point would be my guess.
So in the barracks, you had Lenny Clark, Barry Crimmins, Kevin Meany. Who else?
Right.
Who else?
Rogerson.
Kenny Rogerson.
Kenny Rogerson.
Yeah.
and an array of, you know, maniacs, whoever was passing through.
Why was it called the Barracks?
You have to ask Lenny, but I think just the idea was it was just like too many men in one place. That would be my take.
It could have been, but it wasn't prison, so that's interesting.
Too many men in one place, but yeah, like, yeah, but leading to no good, you know.
Was it a constant party? This is like 19.
Yeah, it was. Yes, yeah, it was a constant party. Yeah, ridiculous. But I was the one who had to work or whatever. Like, I always waited for sundown, and I didn't do coke. So that eliminated me from about 82% of everything. I just happened to be around at some of the key moments. But I was also, like, you know, at that point, I was undercover, a codependent quarterly. You know, I was just... They would just completely ruin everything, and they'd wake up in the morning and everything's clean and there's coffee on, and it's like, yeah. And then note from me and I'm down at the ding working again. You know, I mean, it was, I was a big cover-up artist.
You started the ding ho when you moved to Boston. So you didn't come solely to do stand-up. You also came to bring the stand-up.
Well, I went to see what was going on in Boston. If there was a scene, I would have tried to ingratiate myself and become part of the scene. But there was one kind of nomadic show, the Comedy Connection. It was never quite clear where they were going to be or for how long. At that point, they quickly decided to set some roots in a few places once the ding came along and kind of, I guess, threw down the gauntlet in a sense. But I wasn't thinking in those terms. But there was no set scene, and there was an incredible amount of talent. And I had been around the country enough at that point to know that the big problem with comedy in America, and it remains today, is that comedians are treated like shit.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So we treated the comedians like, you know, like we treat somebody like they were somebody until they proved otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
And if somebody feels like somebody before they walk on the stage, what do you know, when they walk on the stage, they act like they're somebody.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, you know, we had so much great talent, Paula and... Mm-hmm. Stephen Wright, and Jack Gallagher, and Lenny, and Mike Donovan, Mike McDonald, and great comics passing through, like Rooney, and you passed through, didn't
mm-hmm.
you?
Mm-hmm. As you were saying this, I was thinking when I first moved to San Francisco in 82, this was this new wave of, hey, I've got an idea, let's treat comedians with respect.
Yeah.
Right? So I move out to San Francisco, I'm being treated nicely. And I keep thinking, do they know who I am? I swear to God, Barry, I keep going, why are they being so nice to me? Don't they know who I am? Don't they know what I am? You know, because I was a kid.
Yeah,
you know?
Right. And eventually they talk you into thinking you suck. But, I mean, when you're in a business where, yeah, clearly you've probably been in New York and a couple other places where you wait around till 1 a.m. to play to four people, and a lot's on the line. And if you don't do well, you might not get back on again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they treat you like shit. They wear you out. You have to hang around for 9 hours. A million times along the way, you're kind of put in your place. And then you finally get on, and it's a hopeless situation. Like, who are you developing doing that?
Right. There was a big complaint about the San Francisco scene in the 80s. A lot of the New York and L.A. acts would come to San Francisco and say it was bizarro land. Everybody's a star here. They were right. Everybody was a star in San Francisco. And then when they went down to Los Angeles, many of them, because they were treated so well,
right,
did well.
Yeah, well, imagine that. I mean, the Holy City Zoo was the best place I was treated before I came to Boston. But it was still tough. But, you know, they were fair and nice. You know, I was still finding my way. They kept that up out there. The only problem I ever had with San Francisco is so much in that town was predicated on a contest, and I just never believed in contests.
Right. Right.
So it kept me out of there to some extent. I give Rembrandt 3 stars. I just don't believe it. You know? I just don't.
Yeah.
No, I don't. And also, it just doesn't take a lot of things into account. I think the kind of stuff that I've always done is a slightly higher degree of difficulty. And, you know, when I'm up against the pies and seltzer bottles, I may not fare that well.
You know the great Dan Spencer story where he went on and just told jokes with a water pistol in his pocket, but nobody knew it was a water pistol. And every joke he told, he would just do a little squirt. So within 2 minutes, it looked like he pissed his pants. I never saw it, but I heard about it. And I thought, that is an act I would do. I would just be the guy who pisses himself every night. I would nothing would make me happier. And I don't even need a water gun.
Considering your roots, I don't think, you know, I believe you. Because the Zeldo thing, I mean, I know they stole Krusty the Clown from you. They just did. Simple.
Well, not really. I think the idea of...
A sardonic guy in a clown outfit, you know.
It's a natural. They had it on Tunnel Vision. It's been... and then there was Flunky the Clown on Letterman. I started doing it, and then I thought I had stumbled into something. Then somebody told me, well, on Tunnel Vision, there's a clown who reads, I think, D.H. Lawrence to kids. And then there was Flunky the Clown, who went on Letterman right around the same time that I was in the clown suit. And he would smoke a cigarette and talk trash to Dave. It's not an original idea. Before we move on to the truly sad stuff, let's talk about Kevin Meaney for 1 second, because enough time has passed. And, you know, we lost Don Rickles, and Don didn't really have an act. John just went up there, and the more I watched Don Rickles, the more I realized he was a true genius. The opposite of Don Rickles was Kevin Meaney, who had an act, but it wasn't really an act. It was just Kevin.
Well, he was a great entertainer. I think the thing about him that people say, well, he didn't have enough material, it would be that he would repeat certain material, but the ad-libbing improvisation...
Who are we talking about?
Kevin.
Oh, yes,
Kevin.
Okay.
The ad-libbing and the improvisation that he did every night was amazing. And the last time I saw him work, which was on his birthday a year ago, when I had the honor of introducing him on his 60th birthday in Rochester, he absolutely fried that audience. And, you know, just the same as I saw him the first time he worked I got to see him work 35 years earlier, either in San Francisco or Boston. I don't even remember. I think it was San Francisco. But he was a great entertainer. He understood precepts of, you know, show business and showmanship that a lot of people are too hip for these days, or think they're too hip for. But, you know, I mean, he understood it was a show, and he took the stage, and he had incredible charisma and, you know, and presence. And I swear to God, I'd ride over to a gig with him, whatever we're talking about in the car. He'd bring it out on the stage with him and do 15 minutes on that very thing from that day. And they're talking to me about, you know, people go, oh, he didn't have that much material. He didn't, you know, he was so natural on the stage that he could just take anything, act it out, you know, and then just the fact that he was like really a multi-threat entertainer, sing, dance, act, do impressions, a bunch of shit I can't do. I
inspire people to be funny.
Oh, and just so funny. And I mean, just so relentlessly funny. And then on top of that, being one of the dearest people I ever knew and one of my dearest friends. And, you know, I still, you know, the other day I went to pick up a phone to call him because it's just such a natural thing to do because we just were always in touch. And I, you know, I really miss him.
The thing about Kevin Meaney is he taught me how to bomb.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Well, I mean, there's nothing better than when we wouldn't quite connect with the audience. And then he would just take it out on them. It was hilarious. I mean, they would generally it would be over with, and he would win that audience over with that. But the best were when they were just too. I mean, and it would literally be something you could trace some physical thing. The sound system sucked, blah blah, whatever it was. You know, what you dreamed of were those rare nights when they just really didn't, he really didn't connect with them at all, because he would just, I mean, at that point, you get to see the funniest thing ever, ever.
Isn't that, in many ways, what comedy is? It's the guy up there who has his own vision. The world doesn't see it. He's fighting for his life up there. I mean, to me, that's what comedy is.
Well, that certainly can be one of the things. I try to avoid being in that situation. That's just me.
Me too.
The exception that proves the rule.
Well, but me too.
Yeah, I would prefer.
But you've never been in a situation that was otherwise. You've never, ever performed without creating a situation where you challenge the audience and push them away and then brought them back. I don't think you've ever had a set where they were with you all the way. You wouldn't allow that.
Yeah, well, probably. I don't know. You think it out more than I do. I just do it. You know, I'm like a see the ball, hit the ball guy. I'm not back in the video room checking to see where my shoulder is.
Right.
You know, I take my swings. I do my preparation. I have some flow to the show figured out. But after that, we'll see what's what. You know, we'll see what's what. I mean, a big part of it, any great comic, not to say I'm one, but, you know, any comic worth their salt really takes a lot of readings from an audience and has a sense. It's almost telepathic where, wow, this always works, but it's not, you know what, they're going to need a little bit more. And then you give them one more line. And with the thing you get back from that is 3 months from now, that last line that you came up with is what remains in your act. You know,
right.
But it's, you know, that thing where you just figure out they're not quite getting it.
I am having trouble following the news because I find it so uninspiring, so uninteresting, so grotesque.
Grotesquely predictable.
Unoriginal, right?
Right, yeah. You're dealing with a person with a real severe personality disorder.
You're talking about my divorce attorney? I'm talking about Trump, not my divorce attorney.
Okay, all right. Okay.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Jesus Christ. man, you distracted me with that.
Sorry.
That's okay. Your divorce attorney.
Okay, we're dealing with a personality disorder.
Yeah, right. And it's not going to change. So, I mean, it's hopelessly predictable. Every once in a blue moon, he'll go on a little bit of a honeymoon with everybody and ask like a human for 5 seconds, and then that goes away. And that's like 5 seconds every 3 months. Everybody's just so hopeful that the nightmare will end that they overweight it. And you know, immediately, the devil on his shoulder is 97 times the size of the angel on his shoulder. And even the angel on his shoulder is a corrupt fuck, you know, so...
At my sister's, we're going to have dinner tonight. I'm in New Jersey. My sister loves you, by the way. Long story. There was an incident at a restaurant a long time ago where you turned on somebody and you're a hero. For many reasons.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
What did I do?
Well, I was going to ask you about whether or not we could plumb the depths of Trump's depravity. My sister was saying to me last night that we're good people, so we can't possibly understand.
That's right. And I've been saying that about a lot of these people for a long time. Like, people go, well, what do you think they're going to do next? You go, like, well, I can't think like those people. It would be a really bad sign if I could think like those people.
Mm-hmm.
But we live in an era where people, you know, if nobody seems to know what's going on, so they're always telling you what's going to happen. I would just like someone who could actually tell me what's going on.
Or what happened.
Yeah, or what happened, exactly. They can't tell you what happened or what is happening, what is going on, what the present moment is. They're always, I think 3 months from now, you're going to see blah. No one remembers that shit. It's sports and politics. That's all you get anymore. It's a bunch of loudmouth, blowhard predictions. You know, who cares?
And everything is a deadline. Everything is urgent. Everything requires a quick decision. And it bleeds into our personal lives. I notice that everything is, I need that yesterday. I need that yesterday. You're just telling me about it. I need it yesterday. And breaking news. And all of a sudden, the nerve gas, the sarin gas, we have to respond to this. It's been going on for years. But all of a sudden,
and now people want me to break down the military effectiveness of this mission. You know what? I'm not one of those guys. I don't figure out how to best blow shit up. Okay, I think it's best to not blow any more shit up. You know, I mean, those Tomahawk missiles they shot off cost $101.41 million a piece times 59. How many daycare centers are there? You know, how much health care?
Right.
That's, you know, and I mean, clearly it didn't do a lot, whatever it is. It was just, it was like literally an $80 million advertisement where, you know, Trump showed he had balls.
Right. Right.
But he also showed that he's completely inconsistent with what he said in the past.
Yeah. He's a tough guy, except for the 5 deferments in Vietnam.
Well, come on. Yeah, I mean, yeah. You know, he's a guy who got up at that convention in Cleveland and basically told all these alleged tough guys that to stand behind him. He's the only one who can protect us. Really? You haven't left the house without 4 bodyguards in 30 years. You're going to protect me, rich boy, heir to pimp and slumlord fortune? Screw you. You know, you're a self-loathing jagoff who knows you come from scum. And so you're out to prove that, you know, you want the whole world to overcome your self-loathing. And so you're just this ridiculous, narcissistic, egomaniacal, sick son of a bitch. And unfortunately, there's a lot of people in this country who have never dealt with the abuse they've suffered. And so he rings a tuning fork in them. And now we're all stuck in the backseat of a really bad station wagon with the most abusive father ever for the next 4 years.
Right. And you're thinking, well, better my sister than me.
Yeah, right, right, right. You know? Right. Well, it's like those idiots who like comics who just really give shit to people for no reason at all because they're laughing, mostly because they know, oh, at least it's not me.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
we started when I started, Reagan was president.
Mm-hmm. I started with Nixon.
Okay. You started.
Nixon was like, was herpes, you know, you'd think he was gone bruh, and he'd flare up.
But when did you start? What year?
72.
You really did start when Nixon was president.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, my God.
Yeah, it was hard. I mean, I spent 5-6 years opening for, you know, cover bands and bars.
You started
explaining to everybody what comedy was. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I had no idea. I thought you started around the time I did.
No. No, 45 years. I started when I was, I guess I was 19. I'll be 64 this year. So this is
okay.
45th. Yeah.
That's interesting.
My 46th year.
Is it the same? Are the audiences the same, or have they changed? I have a theory that people do remember the past. They stop caring about it. They don't forget the past. They remember the invasion of Iraq in 2003. They just don't care.
Well, maybe, but. You know, when you bring it up to them and you provide the proper context and it leads to something else, they make the connections. You know, I the average person these days is just so overloaded. You know, I think it all comes back to the damn cars. Just you start your day in the traffic jam, you come home, you're in a traffic jam, and in the daytime, it puts you in a real paranoid mood. You turn on the radio, you listen to some right-wing guy who sounds like you feel about everybody else in traffic. You get conned into that state of mind. And then you go sit. Some middle manager is kicking the shit out of you all day at your cubicle, and you're looking around at everybody else in the office because they're always threatening everybody with layoffs. You just live in this cutthroat, awful world all the time. So that they're not sitting around considering the recent past and how it affects them or how it might affect their children is understandable. We have to explain to them. It's our job to explain to them why it is important and why maybe they should just listen to music when they're in the traffic jam and understand that everybody else is in the traffic jam and maybe we should all work together for mass transit and not mass murder.
Wow.
How am I doing today, Feldo?
Fantastic. What is your information diet? Because I'm having trouble getting my juices flowing every morning to read about this stuff.
I'll tell you what. I watched you CNN for 10 minutes, and it picked enough. And it's like, you know, it's like the syrup from which I work the rest of the day. You know, just like, okay, I heard those 12 hunks of conventional wisdom. You know, and you know, I got more than enough. I got more than enough to stay after them at that point, you know. And then after that, you know, I just jump around, you know, wherever. I read, you know, I read a variety of things, and I don't have this thing where if they don't, you know, I'll go back to a website even though I see stuff on there often that I disagree with, you know, generally. Just generally that stuff. You know, the people right now who bother me the most are the ones who are just so worried about the Democratic Party, because it's this search for a leader. We need to be leaders in our own lives. We need to stand up and speak up for people at moments when it's called for. We need to stand up for someone who's being bullied or mistreated. We need to not go along with a racist when we're with a bunch of white people and a couple of them are snickering about something. We need to take a variety of stands. And when we do that, when we behave, act on our conscience on a regular basis, our search for a leader will end in the mirror. And then we will become a nation of leaders, and then we will have caught on, and we will expect the same sort of conduct out of our leaders. And there's not a bigger follower in the world than a politician who understands that the folks have caught on. So That's what I'm. And I think it requires a lot of compassion, a lot of love. And I think that is really the antidote to the Trump stuff, you know, because he doesn't know what to do with that shit. And I don't mean direct love towards him, because that's a waste of time. But, you know, don't hate everybody who voted for him. You know, they're just screwed over people, and they put the wrong monster on the wrong face on the monster and trick them. Oh, that's the problem with the country. They're giving cheese to black people. You know, just like, no, the problem isn't Negro cheese. The problem is fucking, you know, the problem is that, you know, there isn't more than just this shitty cheese to give into them. And by the way, you. I mean, I can't tell you how many people around here who completely depend on government programs who voted for Trump in upstate New York. You know, they just did.
And is that ignorance?
Yeah, it's ignorance. It's being victims of propaganda, and it's also just being exploited for your own self-loathing, you know, your own, you know, I mean, just your own irrationality, your own just like, well, lash out at something. And also, it's a feeling, you know, people know they're getting screwed over with the Democrat as the president, so they want change. They want some sort of change. Unfortunately, in this country only goes in two directions, nowhere and reverse. And we didn't are, you know.
So, you know about the Powell memo, right? The Powell memo. The Powell memo was written, I think, in 1971 by Lewis Powell for the Chamber of Commerce, and he outlined this plan on how businesses can fight Ralph Nader and the left wing. And they created all these think tanks, and it was the Republican Party and the Koch brothers and the Heritage Foundation and the Cato Institute all fighting.
Coors.
With the country as dumb as it is right now, and uneducated, and not civic,
and then you look at how often those their very advertising just plays to, you know, brainless nationalism, jingoistic themes, and it's a nightmare.
I don't believe in conspiracies unless I feel disenfranchised.
Yeah,
then I'm susceptible to conspiracy theories, and I do feel disenfranchised.
Yeah.
The state of the news, the way we get information, the massive amount of citizens who just don't understand the issues. Was there a conscious decision to dumb down the citizenry?
Well, I mean, part of it was greed. You get that thing where if you just sensationalize everything, you get more followers. But part of it is self-censorship. And that is, as the media became more corporate, they don't, you know, I've been involved with corporate media. I know people in the corporate media. They don't ever say, don't discuss this, don't discuss that. But you understand after you bring in one or two stories about prison reform or, you know, environmental racism or something like that, when it just doesn't go anywhere, and you know that you kind of got a demerit against you, and you know if you get fired at this newspaper, you just got fired at 139 other newspapers, you learn what not to cover. I've been through this with the Catholic Church and child abuse again and again, where people are really hot on, you know, because, I mean, I have a very good point that I make about it. It's like, when is there going to be a federal investigation of the crime wave against children by this incredibly powerful organization in our country? When is someone going to hold them accountable in the same way you would hold a CEO of a major corporation accountable for hiding funds and declaring fake bankruptcies after you've had settlements made against you? You know, and then you cover it up. I mean, literally, the Bishop of the Cardinal of New York, Dolan, when he was in Milwaukee, there was a big supposed payoff for all those deaf kids from that school that had just been so egregiously, you know, raped and abused forever. There's letters between him and the Vatican. Oh, don't worry about it. I'm just going to hide all the money in this burial fund, literally a burial fund, and we'll declare bankruptcy and they'll never collect anything. And that's exactly what happened. If General Electric did that, they would get nailed. They would at least take the CEO away in handcuffs. He might not spend a day in jail, but he'd at least face that embarrassment. It doesn't happen with this church. And people, you know what? Every town, eventually, you find out that the bishop is pretty connected and knows everybody and controls a lot of stuff. And he's got ears everywhere.
Let me ask you a couple questions about this, because we had Louis Theroux on from the BBC, and he just did an amazing documentary that's in theaters right now called My Scientology Movie. And one of the questions I asked
him, which is pretty funny, right? Is that pretty funny, right?
It's a funny movie.
Yeah.
I said, well, you know, it's just a religion, you know? Aren't all religions shakedown operations? When you read about Scientology, the cult, and your experience with the Catholic Church, how angry do you get at Scientology?
Well, I get angry at Scientology. I mean, you know, first off, they give you a personality test, and if you have one, they move on to the next potential victim. I am a Catholic, and I am a Catholic, or I was a Catholic, you know, and I arose from that, and I know, you know, the worldwide impact of what they've done. The Catholic Church has done more damage to Ireland than the Brits did, you know? They controlled every element of that society, every element, and with their draconian, you know, hateful, anti-humanist teachings, and the horrible misogyny, and literally enslaving women who were pregnant, often by priests, and taking their children and, you know, forcing them to be born, but then not caring for them enough that a lot of them died and get buried in these, in, you know, like sewage, baptized. You know, I mean, there is such deep, and you know, the physical, the beatings and whatever, but just right down the line, this sort of like imposition of, you know, while the front office lived well, this imposition of sort of like a Calvinist lifestyle on the poor of Ireland. Mm-hmm. You know, they just did a huge amount of damage, but they controlled everything. no matter where you went. They controlled the media, they controlled the government, they controlled, you know, obviously the churches, the schools, the hospitals, you name it, it was all Catholic. And you look at what they did to those people. And then what they did, how many children were abused and harmed by that church in that country. And in the mindset, you know, well, right now it's the youngest country in Europe, and those kids are spitting the bit. And Ireland has a great deal of hope right now. They're pushing to get rid of their Eighth Amendment, which here is against cruel and unusual punishment. There, it is cruel and unusual punishment because it outlaws abortion and birth control and every other thing. You know, so.
I'm sorry. What is the Eighth Amendment?
It's just anti-choice. You know,
in Ireland,
it's just yeah, anti-women's reproductive rights.
Is the Catholic Church is it redeemable? Do you feel it's redeemable? Do you believe really?
No. I don't think if this guy's a socialist, like he claims to be. Give me the keys to the vault. I'll help you redistribute some wealth. I mean, do you know how much money they sit on? No, of course not. No one can possibly estimate. There's, you know, how about just letting humanity see the art treasures they've secreted away for centuries? You know, let's just see the booty. You know, that in and of itself, I mean, can we at least look at what you got? It's his job to change the subject and not the church. Right. And he's always, you know, he's always gone which way the wind blew, which is why he was tight with the death squad people back in the day in Argentina.
So you said see the booty, and I'm not going to take the bait. The thing that I don't understand.
Oh, I wouldn't.
I know.
It wasn't bait. Not coming from me.
I know. But it was just, I know. I'm better than that. No, I'm not. The thing I don't understand.
You're not.
I know.
I am. I'll give you that.
So the thing I don't understand about the Catholic Church, I'm a defender. You're going to get angry at me for saying this. I'm a defender of the Catholic Church. I think the good outweighs the bad. And I'm, as we've talked about before, a Theodore White, a Teddy White pragmatist. And I think that the church does some good work. And liberation theology, that kind of stuff. So
church has nothing to do with liberation theology. You want to switch it all over to liberation theology and put the Vatican in Managua, I might have a chat with you. But in the meantime, it's an ancient and corrupt institution that is there basically at this point to preserve its massive wealth.
Okay, and that's what I don't understand. And you have to explain this to me. I look at priests, I look at the Pope, they take vows of celibacy and poverty. So I justify their wealth.
I don't think they all do.
Well, I justify their wealth by saying it's not going to the clerics, it's going to keep the church going. Is that a fair statement? No, that's not a fair statement.
Well, I mean, the reason that they came up with the chastity, or celibacy, was so when the church usurped land and whatever, and then would make somebody a bishop, they would get to keep that land when the bishop died or whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, it all goes back to Greece. It all goes back to greed. And it's and of course, you know, if that can't be passed along to anyone, it could certainly not be passed along to women unless, you know, you happen to be in a nunnery somewhere.
Do we know what the Catholic Church is worth? There's the Vatican Bank.
There is no telling what the Catholic Church is worth. They have so much priceless art, treasures, and God knows what else they have in gold and BM, who knows? There's no telling. But I just know that if this guy is a socialist, if he were really a socialist and he really believed in the redistribution of wealth, he could just throw the keys, you know, to somebody and say, okay, let's start bringing this stuff out in the daylight and divvying it up.
Is there a guy in the Vatican who's balancing the books and knows exactly what the church is worth?
I imagine that there are various levels of that. But I don't think that anyone has a... I think they probably go through generations of their own people who never get near the, you know, the deep fall.
Is it like the Pentagon in that it can't be audited? That nobody really knows the answer to that question?
I don't see how you could because to just go through and put a price again on all this priceless on this art and stuff is, you know, would be a monumental task. So I don't see how you could even make a reasonable guess. I just know they have way too much.
What is liberation theology? When did it start?
Well, it happened in the late 70s, early 80s. And when the church decided to abandon a lot of parishes in Central and South America, at least this is my understanding of it, and they just left behind a bunch of Bibles. And the people that got the Bibles just started emulating Jesus and kind of ignoring the rest of the stuff. Because Bibles are like, you know, what's the most famous Bible? The King James Bible. It doesn't even have sort of like with Jesus Christ. You know, it's just, gee, I wonder who edited this. Oh, render unto Caesar. Oh, I like that. It's subtle but effective. So these people really started behaving in a truly Christian fashion to one another and started thriving. Well, when they started thriving or doing a lot better, the church suddenly got interested in getting back in there again, but then they didn't want the clerics or the people that had gone along with this have the power. They wanted the power to go back to the, you know, the institutional church, and there was a big conflict.
Well, I've been watching movies and reading about Scientology, and there are offshoots of Scientology. I guess the Catholic Church will have another Reformation, maybe? What do you see in 50 years?
Well, I mean, you know, I mean, I don't know. I don't know. It's really, until they break open the vault and really behave in a Christian fashion and really save countless lives they could save, And until they wake up on, you know, birth control and abortion and women's rights and reverse their misogyny and address their homophobia beyond the occasions when it's like a little bit like, okay, we'll be less homophobic now because it will distract you from the fact that we still haven't done shit about the crime wave against children. You know, there's not much to say. I just see the thing as just such a thoroughly unjust organization, completely hampered by its own hypocrisy. That if it stops behaving hypocritically, yeah, that's one thing that could save the church. I don't ever see that happening. There's just, you know, there's the power is just too entrenched there. And this guy is a lost leader. This guy that's in there, it's his job to change the subject and not the church. Great. He's opposed to global warming. Great. I'm opposed. You know, why don't you change the climate of the church and make it more open? Okay. Right. And make it more open. Okay. And let's turn in every one of them. Let's render unto Caesar every one of these goddamn rapists that you're still covering up for. And let's get all the facts out there, and let's pay off the people whose lives have been ruined and who are incapable of really living, you know, normal lives because of the incredible damage done to them by that church and that church's uniformed representatives who teach them that sex is dirty and evil and terrible while they rape them. That's a pretty fucking profound and deep thing. And when you put it out hundreds of thousands of times worldwide, and then you deal with every family, every person, everyone who can't figure out why someone's so screwed up their whole life. Like, I've lost friends to this. People I knew committed suicide as adults and teenagers because of what priests did to them. and there's been no real justice about it. So I'm glad that you have, with all due respect, a bit of a glib take on the fucking Catholic Church, but it's a pox upon humanity as far as I'm concerned. A pox. You know, okay. It might be convenient for you, but I got the dead friend.
Right.
I got the dead friends, you know, and these fuckers killed them by making them hate themselves.
Right. Right.
By making them hate themselves, by teaching them to hate themselves, by first teaching them that whatever was about to happen to them was evil and dirt, and then have some confused, garbled bullshit artist pedophile come and rape them. And then tell them that their family's threat, whatever, to bring down the power of God upon them if they say a word.
Hmm.
And you watch these people deteriorate. Their life.
They rob them of God and their belief system.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. Taking me a long time to get back anywhere with that. And all I was emotionally and verbally abused by a priest every day who hated me because for some reason I was the only one who would go up and serve mass with him, and I had already been raped. And so when he put his hands on me, I hit him with an elbow, and he did it again, I hit him with an elbow again, and he didn't bother me anymore. I was waiting to get in trouble for that. I thought it was weird that I didn't get in trouble, but I couldn't go home and tell my parents I didn't want to serve mass with this monster every morning. So every morning on the altar, this son of a bitch called me everything in the book and sentenced me to hell in front of a bunch of people when I'm this nice little 10-year-old boy who got up, shoveled the walk at the church, you know, put on his surplus and cassock, went up, set up the altar and served mass, and then went out there while this malevolent, evil child rapist would announce to the congregation several times that I was evil. And nobody stood up for me until finally one day somebody said a roundabout leap. After 3 years, at 3 or 4 years. But, you know, every day I was there was a day the guy was frustrated because every day I was there was a day the pond wasn't stocked for him. So I took a big hit on that level.
Every time the you were there every time?
Every time I was there serving mass with him every morning, the pond wasn't stocked. He knew he couldn't rape me, or he was afraid to.
Oh, the pond wasn't stocked. Tried to, I see.
The pond of victims.
Yeah, yeah.
But there were other altar boys there, then that's fresh, you know, that's fresh meat for him. Well, it wasn't. It was me, week after week. I lived near the church. Every week, whoever was scheduled would cancel at the last minute, and then Father Casey, the other priest, would call my parents at 5 a.m., and I would serve that week. And this went on for years.
Has anybody from the church talked to you, or are they all lawyered up?
Oh, they don't talk to me. They don't talk to me. I'll tell you, I was supposed to testify. They made a pretty good settlement in one case. Before they let me, I was on the list of, I was on the, you know, I was going to testify. And they settled that case. My friend Dennis Brennan's case, my friend Dennis Brennan, who said, they said, well, we'll settle, but you can't, I mean, you can say what you thought happened, but you can never say that we settled or anything. And Dennis said, that's never going to happen. He was very courageous. And 5 minutes later, they caved in and gave him the same settlement. And he was a victim of Father Neri's, the same guy I dealt with every day, Thomas Neri. You know, when I think of him, I hope there is a hell. And then I think of two words, extra crispy.
Is there any advice you would give to people who have been molested by priests? Do you advise them to...
Yeah, blow the whistle. Blow the whistle. Blow the whistle. I'll snap.
Yeah, and spiritually, what advice do you give
spiritually,
them?
I would say give them back. Give the poison back to the distributor of the poison. It's theirs. You didn't do anything wrong. You were young. You were exploitable. You don't think you were... I'll tell you what, go look at a bunch of kids that were your age when you were, that are your age. You know, I do a thing where I'll take someone to a school And they'll say, well, I could have done this or I could have done that. I was 11. My younger brother was getting abused, too. I could have done this or that. And I'll take that person to a school, wait for the school to let out, and I'll pick out an 11-year-old kid, and I'll say exactly what he said to me about himself. Right. And the guy go, no. It's like, well, that's who you were. You know? We all know how young 11 is. But yeah. So look at someone just, I would say almost look at it algebraically, like take your name out of the thing and just make it an algebra thing. And just your X or your Y or whatever, and you're going to get the right result. You're going to understand you didn't do anything wrong.
It's tough because I'm not Catholic, but I know they preach forgiveness. So I could see how that rattles inside your head.
Well, here's the thing about forgiveness. Someone's got to apologize before you can really forgive them, don't they?
Right, right.
So, what I don't do is carry malevolence and hatred and vengeance in my heart, and that's about the best I can do. But Thomas Mary never asked me for forgiveness, and so I never forgive him. And the guy who raped me, I've never forgiven him. I have context for him. I know he came up, and I managed to figure out who he was and what happened to him and that he died in prison after living a miserable life of raping little boys. And, I have pity for him, for the bad life he lived. And I feel very fortunate that I didn't become what I resisted. But anyway, how about that Trump?
I was going to say, you're listening to Barry Crimmins. This is our Easter show. We would like to wish you all a happy Easter.
Yeah. Blessed Easter, yes.
Well,
yeah. Welcome back, Jesus.
Well, I thank you for talking about this, and
It just breaks this way sometimes. Most of my interviews aren't about this these days,
yeah.
But
yeah,
it's all right. And I'm sorry about the glib thing, but it's
no. I am. I mean that I if I'm guilty of anything, because from the time I met you,
yeah.
I remember the time I met you, and we had a drink. And I was glib about Ronald Reagan. I had this detached smirk on my face that you wanted to smack off. I remember that. And you said to me, you're not as deeply committed. I sense a detachment to the cause. And I said, I'm not going down to Nicaragua with you. Yeah. And the older I get, the more I become like you, but I am glib. Mm-hmm. I am glib and I am detached and especially on this subject.
Yeah.
I just can't imagine going through what you went through and it's one of those things when it comes to kids where you don't want to look and think about this stuff.
And that's what they play on, you see, David. They play on two things, our kindness and our cowardice. The kindness is you just don't want to believe that this stuff goes on in this world. And the cowardice is it's scary. Look away. And so those two things. So then you put out a guy who's always in white, gets the compact Pope mobile, and talks about global warming, and it makes a few just vague, steps, very baby steps towards gay rights or something, and that's enough. That's a distraction. It's enough of a distraction, and now everybody doesn't have to think about little children getting raped by clerics for the past, however many centuries. But the thing is, that's gone on forever. And it's a sick, insidious thing. And there are people at every level of that church who are guilty as hell of everything and are terrified of anything but a further cover up. And I just think that it is just too rotten, too deeply to the core to do anything but to just occupy the place, burst open the fucking vault and find a way to distribute it to the world's poor people. And I'll tell you what they're doing right now. They're sending all these creeps to the third world. And in the future, we'll hear about this. And believe me, Well, all I can say is I've been right in the past.
Mm-hmm.
About, you know, things that would happen. For instance, 20 some years ago, I said, when you find the people trading child pornography, when you get into their computers, you're going to find pictures from the kids down the street. Pick up the paper any day of the week now and find the way they get to these guys. They get busted on a child pornography rap, and the next thing you know, they're, you find out that they've got, you know, children that they're actively abusing themselves. Obvious case in point, Jared Fogle.
I think the problem, we have to wrap it up. I apologize because I could go, you know.
No.
But I think the problem is twofold, as I see it. One is, personally, as a Jew, I feel ill at ease going after the Catholic Church. Because, uh-huh. You know, I think a lot of...
Well, I'm going to give you something. It's called a dispensation, okay?
Okay, thank you.
We use it in my church a lot.
So I think I make allowances for other religions because I want allowances for my religion. I'll even be glib about Scientology because I'll say, well, no religion is perfect. And it is glib. Secondly, because of the Establishment Clause in the First Amendment, I think the FBI in this country, I think they have trouble prosecuting churches because it looks like the government is kind of...
Render unto Caesar. It doesn't matter what your church is. If you're raping, abusing, physically beating, emotionally abusing children, that's criminal activity.
Okay. Pay taxes and take away their tax-free status. Okay, we're going to wrap it up. By the way, you're going to be at the Throckmorton Theater in San...
Mill Valley.
Mill Valley. Greatest Mill place Valley. In the world. Are you going to see Mort Saul?
I hope so.
He always hangs out there.
Well, I hope he comes in that night.
I would... I would love to sit...
More than welcome to make some remarks.
Yeah. You'll be in Santa Cruz on Sunday and the Throckmorton Theater on...
I'll be in Santa Cruz on Saturday night. The place is either called The Kitchen or Food or something crazy like that. It's this community center place. Mm-hmm. And then on Sunday, you can find it on my Twitter feed, at Crimmins.
Right.
And then on Sunday night, on Monday night, I think I'm at the Punchline, but I haven't heard the final word. I think I'm supposed to do that with Overton on Monday night.
Wow. What a great show. Mm-hmm. Barry Crimmins, and your movie is Call Me Lucky, and follow you on Twitter. What is your handle?
Crimmins, Crimmins. And the special is available on louisck.net, Whatever Threatens You.
Whatever Threatens You is the name of your comedy special.
Yes.
Directed by Louis C.K.
Yes.
And Call Me Lucky is directed by...
Chosen by the fans of the Interrobang, which is a big comedy website, as the best special of last 2016.
Yes. Very good.
Up against some serious bright young competition, so I was flattered. I think I just snuck in.
Yeah.
I was astonished. I mean, I was literally listening to the announcement thinking, I wonder who won my category.
Mm-hmm.
And when they said me, I didn't even register.
Wow. Thank you, sir.
My entire award background. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
I love you, David.
I love you.
My best to your listeners. Okay.